Drexel. And what? Hi, this is Bill O'Donnell, and welcome to a program on spirituality. I'm thrilled to have as my guests in the studio today two friends, Sister June Fisher, an old friend from quite a while ago, and a new friend, Sister Patrick Marie, Sisters of the Blessed Sacrament, and we're here to honor their founder and patron, Saint Katharine Drexel. I still have to get it into my head, and she is the person who was just canonized by Pope John Paul II recently, and so we're here to honor her and to have these sisters come in and tell us about their order and the legacy of Katharine Drexel. Welcome, both of you.
Thank you.
It was a tremendous honor for me to be at the cathedral recently when the Archbishop and all the other dignitaries were there and the place was packed to honor Katharine Drexel because of her connection, long-standing connection with New Mexico, and she is the foundress of your order. In terms of church history, this is big news, something very fresh.
It really is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. How long have either of you been associated with the Sisters of the Blessed Sacrament?
Well, we're contemporaries.
Yeah.
I entered in 1956. Yeah. Sister Patrick Marie.
I entered in 1954. Mm-hmm. She was still living when I entered, but uh-huh. She died then in March of 55. And you don't really realize all the ramifications of your choice. But because we are Sisters of the Blessed Sacrament, that this is the way that all peoples can be united. It doesn't matter, yeah. You know, their background, or the color of their skin, their education, anything, that we really are all one in Christ. And yeah. That was it.
And it's almost a miracle that the Spirit moved this woman, who was an heiress, inheriting something like $20 million in the 1800s. So who knows how much that would have been worth today, and that she felt that this was her call to do something about that. I mean, it's a kind of almost a Hollywood story today, where mm-hmm. someone would do that with that kind of opportunity for power and wealth, and she chose to dedicate her life to helping the disadvantaged, particularly Native Americans and African American children. How did the connection with Santa Fe result? I know we have St. Catherine's Indian School. It's been here over 100 years. I understand mm-hmm. that was her first project before she even became a nun. Who would like to talk about mm-hmm. that?
I guess we can both chime in.
Yeah.
Well, when she and her two sisters were growing up, their family, that was their training in terms of the wealth that was theirs was not just for their own pleasure. It was a responsibility to be shared with others. And after her parents died and the three girls were there with this estate, various peoples were coming to them, appealing to them for financial help. And there were Bishop Marty from South Dakota, and then the priest that was in charge of the Catholic Indian Bureau. So they appealed to the girls to come and help to see for themselves what the needs were among the Native people. So they went, they made their trips out there in stagecoaches, and they saw firsthand what the situation was, what their reality was, and so then they began to help with that need. And among the ways that they did that was Katharine, she started began a number of schools to help with the education. She saw education as a tool to help the people, and St. Catherine's was one of the first ones.
Mm-hmm. Now, she wasn't even a nun yet. She was just a lay person. How old was she at this time?
That was 1887, when she was born in 1858.
Mm-hmm. So New Mexico was only a territory, literally, mm-hmm. when mm-hmm. the school was built and the rest
and
of it.
And actually, it was the bishop at the time who asked her if she would build St. Catherine's.
Yeah.
The archdiocese owned the property, and at that time it was outside the so-called city limits or village limits of Santa Fe. And so she came out and looked at it, and she did give the money for it. I think it cost $12,000 to build it at that time. And that's the main building, which is still in very good condition. And I always said that, you know, that's when the school was still operating, sometimes that was the cost of utilities for 1 month, at, you know, in modern day technology. Yeah.
I was always curious, how were the children selected? How did they get the privilege to come to the school, or was it a privilege back in those days to come to Santa Fe, to leave their family? I imagine there were some trade-offs along those lines, but you know, what groups of Indians or Native Americans were invited to come?
Actually, all of them. Yes. The sisters visited the pueblos in the area, so the three northern ones and the five southern ones were and Isleta and Laguna, mm-hmm. Acoma. Mm-hmm. They just visited them and talked to the leaders of the people. Mm-hmm. You know, the governors and their officers are very important, and you go through them when you want something. And she just visited with them, and the mm-hmm. sisters did, and the people themselves decided if they wanted to take that chance in mm-hmm. taking their letting mm-hmm. their children leave home. Mm-hmm. And when they brought their children, they stayed around mm-hmm. for a while to make sure yes. that, you know, they were going to be well taken care of.
Mm-hmm. And then among the Navajos, the Franciscans were out there. They just celebrated 100 years, 2 years ago. That was in, I guess, 1898. And they did some recruitment there. They went, and Mother Katharine and one of the other sisters went around too and talked to some of the Navajo people, both in terms of St. Michael's School that was started in 1902.
That's in Arizona,
near the Navajo Nation central, you know, headquarters. Mm-hmm. And but some of the Franciscans there would help when before St. Michael's was built, and they helped to get some of the students to come. And so they came from St. Michael's, from Navajo land. Yeah. And they have some interesting stories in some of their annals about the rides over that Narbonne Pass, Washington Pass, and bad weather, and in their they weren't exactly riding in Cadillacs. You know. So it was rugged, but she had help from the Franciscans too.
Yeah, that's an interesting thing. We had Father Larry Dunham, the new provincial for Our Lady of Guadalupe Province, which is now this area, and he claimed that it was Katharine Drexel who brought the Franciscans back, mm-hmm. Went out to Cincinnati and brought them back to the area. And they wouldn't have celebrated their 400th anniversary just a couple of years ago of Franciscan's era if it hadn't been for Catholic Drexel asking them to come back mm-hmm. to the Southwest mm-hmm. and minister to the Native Americans. Mm-hmm. So that was a new fact that wasn't really well known, I thought. Mm-hmm. And of course, there is an obvious closeness then between the Franciscan friars and mm-hmm. and your order, the Blessed Sacrament Sisters. So I still think it's a fascinating story, and unfortunately, St. Catherine's has been closed recently. And I heard the Archbishop say he was hoping for the next miracle that St. Catherine would intercede on behalf to bring life back there. But it's still being used, isn't it, mm-hmm. at this time?
This year, not too much. The last 2 years, Santa Fe Indian School had their mid-school there. And but they have moved back to their own campus, so right now it's not being used too much.
Okay. So if anybody watching out there has any miracle ideas or suggestions,
or $5 million,
or $5 million to come back and renovate the school and invite some more Native Americans and African American kids to come back to Santa Fe, that would be a great contribution. What else can you tell us about the work then? That now, how has the order evolved? I mean, how many women and then have come through now the Sisters of Blessed Sacrament since Catherine started a little over 100 years ago? Any idea?
Well, I think at our peak we had about 650, something like that. Mother Catherine said we'd probably always be small, but you know, small is beautiful too. You can do a lot, you know. Was it another, I don't know if it was Romero who said that things are done sometimes by a small group of people. You don't need numbers to have a strong commitment.
And actually, Jesus mm-hmm. started with 12 apostles. Mm-hmm.
That's right. I'm fascinated because as I think about it today, particularly by today's standard, I mean, it's a radical step for a woman to basically kind of walk away from the world, at least in part. I mean, you are obviously operating in it, but it's one step in and one step out, really, of the world as most of us know it. And what has been the benefit for you two personally to be in a religious order? What's in it for you? Mm-hmm. What have you gotten out of being a sister in consecrated life to the Lord?
What I would say is there's a lot of facets to it, but the fact that you're in a community with people who share the same vision as you do, and that you give each other synergy from sharing in that vision and from working with it and working with each other in trying to achieve that vision, mission, whatever you want to call it. That's one part of it. The other thing is your life is structured in terms of priorities, and priorities in terms of the religious aspect, scheduling time for prayer, for community, and for ministry, weaving them in together. But first of all, the relationship with God, and then with other people. It's not just God and me, it's God and everybody else.
So. I think if people think of religious life as we have given up something, that's kind of a negative aspect of religious life. I don't think I have given up. I chose a way of life just like you chose a way of life, just like anyone in the audience chose a way of life. And no matter what you choose to do, there are certain negative aspects to it, but hopefully the positive outweigh the negative. And I think knowing that you have been called to serve God and to serve His people outweighs everything. We not only have served people, but we have been really deeply loved by people. And that's you know, the blessing of the call. Mm-hmm. To say we gave up, I didn't give up anything.
So when you're working with those young people, do you have a sense of their appreciation, or do they realize that you're there for them? Is that something that's possible?
Oh, I think so.
You feel that?
I used to say to some of the kids, you know, you might not love me now, but in 10 years you will. And I really do believe that, mm-hmm. you know, but that's anyone who works with young people. But I have always felt, you know, that they cared for us, mm-hmm. even, you know, when you were getting after them. Because mm-hmm. they do know, somehow, you know, they know when teachers or people working with them care for them. Mm-hmm. And they return that.
Mm-hmm. Let's talk about the name, Sisters of the Blessed Sacrament. How did Sister Katharine choose that name? And can you explain to the people why it's so significant? Mm-hmm.
I always find that difficult to explain, because I don't know if you really can. First of all, it's a mystery. But in terms of Blessed Sacrament, referring to, this is maybe our jargon, but it's not jargon really. It's Christ in the Eucharist, and Eucharist meaning Thanksgiving. And that's related to, in the Catholic way, what we call the Mass, or the Eucharistic liturgy. And which is basically a reenactment of what happened at the Last Supper when Christ gave His body and blood for us, and which happened on Calvary. So it's reenacting that mystery and becoming part of it. And so one of the quotes that Mother Catharine would give us is, the spirit of the congregation, our community, is the spirit of the Eucharist, and that is the total gift of self. And just as Christ gave His body and blood for us, so we are called to give of ourselves totally, total gift of self, to God and to the peoples among whom we work.
What is your personal experience when you receive the Blessed Sacrament?
Well, I would say that it's really, it's the source of love, source of energy, the source of motivation and remotivation. Not that you're on a high, when, you know, but it's because of the faith base of that, that it's a need, and it's a source of nourishment. and a source of being able to continue to give. Give us this day our daily bread, that kind of a thing. And so it's the daily bread that enables you to go on. It's like in the Black community, they say if they have church on Sunday, they can get through the rest of the week. Uh-huh. You know, so it's a similar kind of idea.
Yeah. How about for you, Sister Katharine?
It's a means of being united with Christ, and that's who we have chosen to follow, to be one with. St. Paul mentions about one bread and one body. It's a way of gathering all peoples together in one, and I think that was one reason that Mother Katharine chose the Blessed Sacrament. We weren't just to be teachers or social workers or that, but we were supposed to be united with Christ and with all peoples. And that's what the Blessed Sacrament is all about, uniting people. When you can break bread with somebody, then you share with them. And you don't break bread with somebody that you can't share with. And that's what Eucharist is, breaking bread.
Another aspect, if I might add,
please.
With Katharine, the whole thing of the Eucharist, as Sister Patrick Marie was saying about we're all one body in Christ, and that some people weren't welcome at the table. And so part of that being a Blessed Sacrament is that everybody has a place at the table, especially those who seem most unwelcome. They have a place, a rightful place. And certainly in Christ, that was Christ's vision, you know.
As women in the world now in this new millennium, what advice would you have for other women out there who don't know the advantages of trying to develop their spiritual life? What advice would you have for them, or what encouragement would you give them wherever they are and whatever their circumstances are?
I think I would tell them, take time. Life can be busy, but we have time for anything we want to do if it's important. And if somebody is really searching for God, then you set aside time. You deliberately do that. You pray, whether it's a very simple, you know, Jesus, let me know what I should do. You read books. You meet people who are searching also, or people who are convinced of the church and what the church has to offer.
Hey, how about you, June? What advice would you have for women, and particularly women who perhaps maybe feel alienated from the church because of the, you know, the feelings that, you know, women aren't appreciated in the church? And I'm sure there's evidence for that. But what encouragement would you have for them in their spiritual life if that's a block for them?
Mm-hmm. Well, that's difficult to answer. But each person has to do her own inner journey to begin with. And there are places that of hurt and places that need healing. And so I'd say to do that inner journey, to get to a place, you know, to at least get into the process of trying to see, you know, what's causing it and what's the attitude toward it and to work towards healing with it. The other thing would be to seek out, you know, guidance, or to seek out persons who can help you to see the issues or the problems and to work through them, or at least to work with them. So I would say that. And then to get to know yourself is basically what would be important, and then to get the help of other people in doing that. People that you can trust, that have wisdom, that have, you know, objectivity, that have some kind of skills that can help you with that journey. Mm-hmm.
What advice would you have for women at home today who thought, well, maybe, you know, I didn't find fulfillment on the outside, and maybe, is there a place, say, in middle age or later for women who perhaps a change of circumstance in their life that they thought, well, maybe it's not too late for me. Maybe a religious community would be something that would help me in my life. What advice would you have for them? Either of you.
Well, it's been one of the trends today in the last 10, 15, 20 years, that more older, not that they're old, but they're not right out of high school, that they've had other life experiences and they're not satisfied and they are looking for something. And I think Santa Fe is a good example of a lot of people who are seeking, and it's usually a spiritual kind of seeking, and it's kind of a holistic kind of seeking for themselves and so on. So there's been more of an openness in communities, and more of the women who come are a little older. And so it's like, it's not too late, no. Just
what other parts of the country is your order operating currently?
In California. We have two sisters in Los Angeles. We have St. Michael's High School in Arizona near Window Rock. There are four of us here in Santa Fe ministering. Chicago. Mm-hmm.
Pennsylvania.
Philadelphia, New Orleans, Atlanta.
So across the country.
Yeah.
There are opportunities for women across the country.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And so all they would have to do is just contact you if they want to find out more about the order and what opportunities there might be for them?
That's right. They could contact us at St. Catharines, but it doesn't have to be women who have already experienced some life. It could be young people.
Young people as well.
We would like to see, younger women try Jesus, try at least really think about vocations. You said that you heard me speak at the cathedral when we had the Mass and to honor Mother Catherine. And what I said about my father was really true. And he wrote to me right before I was going to be professed. And he said, happiness is found in service. And service to our Lord in the Blessed Sacrament has to be the most gratifying. And that's true. And if you're not serving people in some way or other, that's what's missing in your life. And, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if you can't be a priest. It doesn't matter if the Catholic Church is rather male-oriented. We still, as women, have a call in the Church. And we have to answer that call. Whether things will change as far as, the male domination, I don't know. I just know there's too much to do to get bogged down in that issue. I mean, not that it shouldn't be addressed, but there's just too much to do for the Church, too much to do for Christ that, you want to do it. You want to see that these people are educated, that they meet Christ, and their lives become better because of it.
So their spiritual lives are important, and
absolutely.
And this is one way that people have a chance to serve others, and it actually helps them by the opportunity to serve others.
That's right.
If you're living just a selfish life, it's going to be a pretty narrow one. Well, just in the few minutes that we have left, I want to thank you for coming in. Any final comments you'd like to share? I mean, this has obviously been a heady time for you and your order. Mm-hmm. I mean, when your founder is made a saint. How has that affected you? I mean, that's got to be an exciting time.
It is exciting, and it's been a kind of a renewal, and it's just been a time of affirmation and gratitude, like the celebration, and part of that whole hundredfold has been sharing life with so many of the people and the richness of cultures, and so.
I know some of your alumni from the Thunderbirds, they were heard from in the cathedral that night. I don't know who called for the yell, but
I did.
It was great. It was great. And to see the Native American dancers, too, the blending of the Native American culture and Catholicism in the cathedral is just extraordinary. I didn't know these things went on, but it's a marvelous blend of spiritualities, it seems.
If people just see Indian dances as an entertainment, then they missed it, because when the people dance, it's prayer. And that's why we ask them to dance. It was their way of praying with and for us, and that's why we had the buffalo dancers and the eagle dancers.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they're very special. Mm-hmm. Okay, I don't know how much time we have, but okay, we have just a couple of minutes. There was one other thing that I wanted to mention. I love the blend of the cultures, and you've had a chance to work with both Native American and African American kids. Is there any distinguishing with you? I mean, they're both children. What comments would you have the difference there in your ministry?
I'd just like to say they're more children and adults. It's all multi-ages, not just children in schools. We do a lot of other, you know, pastoral ministry and so on. Even among the Indian tribes, each one's distinct.
Yeah.
And then the black and the, you know, they have different gifts, that's the idea, and different cultures. But that's been part of our privilege to be, to become part of, included in their lives and their cultures.
Yeah, because you get that benefit of actually being accepted into their culture and see it a whole different way. Mm-hmm. All right, well, listen, we have run out of time, so thank you again for coming in. If you have any questions that you'd like to address to Sister Patrick Marie or Sister June, stay tuned for the credits. Their phone number and address, an email address will be there in the credits. Be sure and write them down and give them a call if you have any questions. And for those you, those angels out there with large purses that would like to help out this worthy group, feel free to give them a call. We'd love to hear from you. All right, so thank you for viewing, and on behalf of all of us here at Spirituality, I want to thank you, and stay tuned next week at this time for another program on spirituality. Okay, great.